of cheat sheet tonight because there's a lot of things I need to say. There's a kind of a whistle in this.
It's a feedback, yeah. You're getting feedback on it.
Am I too close to something? Okay, yeah, that's much better. All right, I'm Helen Wilson, Vice President of Squirrel Hill Historical Society. Michael, our president, Michael Ehrman, couldn't be here tonight, so I'm going to be starting the meeting. And first thing I want to do is introduce our other board members. Is Betty here? Our other Vice President and Treasurer and Secretary, Betty Connolly. And our treasurer is Evelyn Young, and I don't think she's here.
She's in Hong Kong,
though. Oh, she's traveling also. Okay, our webmaster is Patty Hughes, sitting in the back. PR person and audiovisual, Audrey Glickman, running the camera tonight. Ralph Lund, one of our board members, is right there. Toby Chapman.
He's
probably
in China.
Traveling. What?
He's in China.
And Jim Hammond is here too. So there.
Oh yeah, that's
okay.
Right. I saw Toby here.
Now I noticed that there's three groups of people who come to Squirrel Hill Historical Society meetings, and one group is our regulars, mostly our members who come to practically every meeting, and we really thank you. You're our mainstay. And then we have a second group of people who come because they're interested in the subject that's being, if they hear that there's going to be a talk on bridges and they like bridges or whatever, and they come, and we appreciate you coming. And then there's a third group of people who are composed of people who know either the speaker or is related to him, or anyway, they're sort of, in a way, they're speaker groupies who follow a speaker around. So thank you to all of you. But I do want to mention that if you're a member, you might think, well, the meetings are free. Why should we become a member? What's in it for me? Well, what I did was, we have a newsletter that goes out every month, and the newsletter has articles in it from different researchers, especially, and I do want to acknowledge Wayne Bossinger. If you're a member, you have seen his wonderful articles in the newsletters. And what I've done is made a complimentary copy so you have an idea of what the newsletter looks like. And again, this goes out every month. And everything in here has been in one of the newsletters of the past few months, starting with a message from our president saying the different things that the organization has done. And our dues go to support these outreach programs that we have, and renting of this hall, insurance, and things like that. So the dues are really necessary. And there's also a list of the upcoming presentations, and there's also some articles that have been in recent magazines that we just don't have time to present to you. So, but there are things about Squirrel Hill. There's an article in here about Reach Cordic, and there's an article about, we were tracking, especially Wayne was looking into the connection between Somerset and Colonel Byrd, who was here before the Revolutionary War. So anyway, if you want, pick one up after the meeting. They're on the table back there. And if you read the message to the president, he mentions that someone gave us a stack of Squirrel Hill newspapers. It was this high. Bound copies from 1935 to the 1960s. Moldy, dust, poisonous. Well, Carnegie Library digitized them for us. And I had to bring this to show you because this headline from 1935, GOP dissension flares. So there's nothing new under the sun. Now, these are going to be on microfiche and in the Carnegie Library and the Pennsylvania Department in the main in Oakland. But we're working on getting them. They're digitized now, but they're JPEGs. But what we need to do is put them into a PDF format that is searchable for us researchers. Instead of having to go through years of work, we can type in a keyword. And that's going to take a lot of doing because there's like 35 gigabytes of this stuff. So anyway, this is another outreach thing that if you are interested in becoming a member, we would really appreciate it. So
they want help making PDF.
Checking my cheat sheet here. One announcement about the Frick Park Walk on June 4th. There's still a few places left. It's on Saturday, June 4th. If anybody's interested, there's some sign-up sheets in the back. It's a walking tour of Frick Park with Susan Rademacher from Pittsburgh Parks Conservancy. And she did it a few years ago, and it's very, very interesting. So if you're interested, sign up at the end of the meeting. Michael gave me a list of things that he had asked me to mention, and one of them was our upcoming talks, June 14th. It's also it has a political relationship. Steve Mahaley, retired vice president of the H.J. Heinz Company, will bring items from his collection of 20,000 political campaign memorabilia. And all the way from Washington. I mean, this is not, his political buttons and other things are nothing new. So he's going to bring some of them and talk about how they relate to the elections. So that should be very interesting. And then in July, we have a double feature. Our regular meeting is going to be Maury Sable, and he's going to talk about, this is almost forgotten now, but Squirrel Hill was once the West Liberty auto showcase of Pittsburgh. There were more cars in the East End than anywhere else, and there were dealerships up and down Forbes and Murray and forward, and gas stations. So he's going to talk about those. So that's July the 2nd Tuesday. And then if you remember, I hate to bring winter up, but our January talk was canceled, so we rescheduled it for the 4th Tuesday in July, and that is Linda Nyman, who is going to talk about 150 years of beer at Penn Brewery. So talk about the history of the Penn Brewery. So a lot of people were very disappointed that that was canceled, so we decided to reschedule it. So that's the 4th. Fourth Tuesday in July. And now Audrey is going to talk about the Bicentennial Parade. So, Audrey?
Does that break the fourth wall? On July 9th, Saturday, whether you're a part of the group of people who always comes, the group of people who comes for the particular speaker, or you're a relative of anybody who's ever spoken, please put it on your calendar to join us. There's a parade downtown celebrating Pittsburgh's bicentennial, which is happening throughout the year. But this is the big showcase event. Descendants of all the mayors, whoever were, are going to be in this parade. And the Historical Society is marching. We're going to have a banner. The parade is set to step off at 10th and Liberty at 1 o'clock. We don't have instructions yet how early we're going to be gathering. Presume it to be between 12 and 1 arrival. If you can sketch it in on your calendar, please. We're going to make a big showing. Squirrel Hill is the best. Thank you, Helen. I don't see you marking it on your calendars.
And now for our speaker. And in all the times I've heard Todd talk, I have never once introduced him, and he's my son. So he is a civil engineer, Todd Wilson, and I can vouch for the fact that his passion for bridges it started in kindergarten and has never waned through his science projects in elementary and middle school, his senior project at Aldergeist, and his civil engineering career at CMU, where he had a double major. The other major besides civil engineering was, I have to see, it's one of those, you know, engineering and public policy. So he can explain what that is. So let's see. His love of bridges has sent him on a quest to photograph bridges in every state, and now he's working on countries. He's up to 17 countries. Let's see. I'm sorry. I'm usually not this nervous, but maybe it's the occasion. Anyway, he's now a project engineer at Homestead-based GAI consultants. And in 2010, he was named one of the 10 new faces of civil engineering by the American Society of Civil Engineers. In 2011, he was chosen as one of Pittsburgh's 40 under 40. In the same year, he received the Carnegie Mellon University Department of Civil Engineering's recent Alumnus Achievement Award. Now, he currently serves in his spare time as a trustee of Pittsburgh History and Landmarks Foundation and the History and Heritage Committee Chair of the Pittsburgh Section. In 2015, and part of the reason why he's here, he co-authored the book Pittsburgh's Bridges from Arcadia Publishing. So here he is, Todd Wilson.
Well, thank you, everyone. It's always an honor and a privilege to be able to speak in Squirrel Hill to the Squirrel Hill Historical Society. I'm pleased that, I guess maybe about 5 years ago, I had the opportunity to present here, and it was a wonderful occasion and very excited to be back. Now, one thing Helen neglected to mention is she served as the co-author on the book and Pittsburgh's Bridges, which, again, was published in... So, as you mentioned, I've really been interested in bridges my entire life, and what's really exciting about writing a book is to have the opportunity to do research and find things that might not be commonly known. So I'm thrilled to present some of the fruits of this research with you. So, as we know, Pittsburgh is a city that's defined by its bridges. It's hard to go anywhere if you don't cross a bridge. Well, what about back before human development? Certainly there were no bridges, right? So when did the first bridges of Pittsburgh be constructed? Well, when Fort Pitt was constructed, and Pittsburgh went from the forks of the Ohio to being the beginnings of Pittsburgh, notice there were bridges into the fort. So as long as this area has become associated with Pittsburgh, we've been using bridges to come in and out. So bridges have always been very important to this area as far as development's concerned. Now, 200 years ago, Pittsburgh became a city, incorporated as a city. Here's a view of Pittsburgh from 1817. Notice, no bridges, no river bridges specified. That came shortly afterwards in 1818, when this first Smithfield Street Bridge was constructed. Now, it was a wooden covered bridge. If you've ever wondered why was the Smithfield Street Bridge built there, well, here's what's today downtown, here's the bridge, and notice there's a road. This is present day Sycamore Street, which goes up to the top of Mount Washington, or Coal Hill, as it was known then, due to all of the mining activities. Now today, Sycamore Street has a bridge and connects over here. So it's a different alignment, but back then, this was the only way to get up to the mining activities on Coal Hill. The first bridge over the Allegheny River opened a year later in 1819, and it connected from downtown right into the heart of the north side, which was previously the separate city of Allegheny. You can see both of the, and this was at 6th Street. And again, this connection was a lot more logical before the circle was built And as you can see, it's another wooden covered bridge. Now, all of these early bridges were toll bridges, where a group of investors would get together if they thought there might be enough traffic to upgrade a ferry crossing with a bridge, that they would construct the bridge and use the toll revenue to pay for the bridge and to pay for maintenance. Now, especially in the early days, there might not be enough investment, or there might be concerns about the vibrancy of the project. And this is where public funding came in, where the government had some investment in these private companies. But that practice ended pretty much by the 1840s. This is the old 7th Street Bridge, and notice the toll house and the toll collector. Now, in the early 1800s, Pittsburgh found itself losing out to westward expansion. The National Road was constructed from Baltimore in 1818. Notice that it bypassed Pittsburgh, going through Brownsville and Wheeling. Pittsburgh was out of the way. Meanwhile, the Erie Canal was completed in 1825 across from the Hudson River to the Great Lakes in New York. Pittsburgh was not directly on either route. Therefore, Pittsburgh's business interests petitioned the legislature to build a canal across the state, build a canal to connect Philadelphia with Pittsburgh. It's one problem. The surveyors determined that the north bank of the Allegheny River was more suited for construction. Well, at the time, the north bank was the rival city of Allegheny. Needless to say, Pittsburgh was not happy. We build this canal and it's going there? It's going to our rival? So the solution was to construct an aqueduct over the Allegheny River, and that was at approximately where the railroad bridge is today, near the convention center. That was completed in 1829. Now, there were frequent maintenance problems with this aqueduct, and there were times where the content of the water would flow back into the Allegheny when the bridge would spring a leak. Now, a side note, John Roebling, he was the man who was able to solve this problem with the new bridge. But before we get to that, he emigrated from Prussia in 1831 to Butler County. Now, he was trained in Europe, and he was hired by the Pennsylvania Canal in 1837, where he worked on the canal's inclines. Why would the canal have inclines? How do you get a canal through the Allegheny Mountains? Water doesn't flow uphill. So the engineers solved this problem by building various inclines. So the canal boats, as you can see here, would be put on mule or horse-drawn rail cars and moved up and down the mountains by inclines. And off of Route 22 around Crescent, Pennsylvania, there's a National Historic Site,
right,
which you can see a reconstruction of one of the incline houses, as well as remnants of the old canal route. So these boats were pulled up and down the mountains with hemp ropes that had a lifespan of about 16, 18 months, and the ropes would snap. Initially, there were catastrophes, there were fatalities, and these ropes were quite a problem. Roebling in Europe developed a love of suspension bridges. He was working on the canal and realized a way of spinning wire into rope to form wire rope, which replaced those hemp ropes. And with that, he really wanted to study suspension bridges. He said in the study, when he was trying to get a job to work on a suspension bridge here in America in 1840, he said, "The study of suspension bridges formed for the last few years of my residence in Europe my favorite occupation." Well, with that troublesome Allegheny aqueduct, he had his chance. So Roebling's very first suspension bridge was right here in Pittsburgh. This was a drawing of the bridge, and this is what it looked like. This is a different canal aqueduct that he did 3 years later over the Delaware River. This one is still standing, but this gives you an idea of what it looked like. And why did he have this opportunity? Because of low cost. Now, for Roebling, he was in the right place at the right time. That bridge was built in 1845. Also in 1845 was Pittsburgh's Great Fire, which caught the old Smithfield Street Bridge on fire and the wood burned, but the piers remained. Again, Roebling was able to propose an economical solution to fit a suspension bridge to those surviving piers. And this became Roebling's first vehicular bridge, again, right here in Pittsburgh. A year later, Roebling was getting ambitious and proposed this concept for a suspension bridge at the point. Now, just to orient you, this is where Mount Washington is. Hines Field would be over here, which would include the land of this island, which is no longer an island, it's part of the north side, and this is the point. Now, why would you build a bridge with a leg that would have a bridge to the point? Well, today we know the rivers that are essentially pooled by locks and dams. Back then, the water levels fluctuated a lot. So if you were going to connect to the point, where would you tie in the bridge that it would be above high water? This was an interesting concept that would have solved that problem and accounted for the river's fluctuation. But this was a very costly solution, as you can imagine, because you're essentially building multiple bridges. It did not attract sufficient investment, and merchants were worried if something happened to this bridge or if it was too low for boats, it would block the port of Pittsburgh. So it wasn't built. Roebling's final bridge in Pittsburgh was built at 6th Street. This is to replace the original bridge. So both of the original bridges over the Mon and Allegheny were replaced with Roebling suspension bridges. But back then, it was also a private company, and the private company thought, if we hired Roebling to build a beautiful bridge, and I don't know about you, but I think this is a pretty beautiful bridge, we can capture traffic from our competitor at 9th Street. And they noticed a spike in business when this new beautiful bridge was built, where people chose to cross this bridge over the covered bridge at 9th Street. The first railroad bridge in Pittsburgh was built opened in 1857. The railroad was constructed in the early 1850s to compete with the canal. Very quickly, it put the canal out of business, and the railroad bought the canal right-of-way and used a lot of that right-of-way to improve their alignment, to improve the tracks. That same year, the wooden Allegheny River Bridge opened, and it was replaced just a few years later in 1864 with this European-style iron lattice girder. I only know of one remaining iron lattice girder anywhere in America, though they're rather common in Europe. So, today we all know about the city owning bridges, PennDOT owning bridges. If everything was private then, what caused this transition to publicly owned bridges? Well, one of the reasons was annexation. The city of Pittsburgh grew by annexing other municipalities that were formerly independent. So for an example, and this is the city's first, the Brady Street Bridge, which crossed from the south side of Birmingham to the city. When the city annexed Birmingham, these new city residents still would have to pay a toll to cross 10th Street into the city. As the city grew, the new residents wanted free travel within the city and thought this is something that the government should provide. So in 1896, this bridge was built as the city's first bridge that they owned. And then the city, later the county, and also the state began to purchase the various bridges in the area. So it wasn't until 1926 with the Glenwood Bridge that all of the bridges in this area became free for travel. If you go to East Liverpool, Ohio, there's still a privately run toll bridge over the Ohio River, and that one's from 1905. My mother is quite afraid to cross that bridge, so if you have the opportunity, it's quite enjoyable, I think. So in 1895, the Allegheny County Public Works Department formed, and their first bridge was built about 1910, and that was the Halton Bridge, the one that was just demolished. And then in 1924, Joseph Armstrong, as we know him from the Armstrong Tunnel, who was the city's public works director, then the city's mayor, and then county commissioner, so he has this background in transportation, began advocating this ultimate highway system to bring Pittsburgh into the automobile age. And a lot of the boulevards, the large county boulevards, Allegheny River Boulevard, Ohio River Boulevard, they were built through this program as well as most of the bridges that we know and hopefully love today. Lastly, the Pennsylvania Department of Highways was formed in 1903. The state highways, the route numbers that we know today, were first designated in 1911, and PennDOT was formed in 1970. And there's an example of the first state-built river bridge in the city, the Fort Pitt Bridge. The last thing, as part of the introduction, is the formation of Pittsburgh's Municipal Art Commission. As the city was growing very quickly with the industrial period, there was little concern with how some structures looked. A lot of things were built very hastily. Various parts of the cities developed into slums. The director of the Carnegie Institute advocated that the city form an art commission that would approve designs for any civic structures, not just bridges, but buildings and things like that. So the commission was created, but maybe an unintended consequence, but the commission began to view the bridge's structure itself as part of its artistic merit. They thought this commission would want to decorate bridges, but the commission went beyond that, and you'll see that coming up. And that's one of the reasons why we have such beautiful bridges. This is a detail from the Larmer Avenue Bridge. The bridge is still here, but this detail is not of this lamppost with the eagle and globes. It's really quite beautiful. And Stanley Ruch was the civic architect who presided. He was responsible for the architecture of a lot of these bridges, as well as some of the buildings, like the county office building and the county airport. So rather than going through following the rivers, I'm just going to go through a few different highlights, because there are so many beautiful, fascinating bridges. Just pick up some of the very best highlights for you. And we'll start with the city's oldest river crossing, the Smithfield Street Bridge. Now, here's an image of the old Roebling suspension bridge we talked about. Now, the private company that owned it decided they wanted to upgrade the bridge. And one of the things that was going on in the mid to late 1800s is streetcars. First, mule-pulled cars, and then later the electric trolleys. So they started to upgrade the bridge, but then this company chose a design, a two-tower suspension bridge. They ordered the iron for the bridge, and then the company was bought by another company. The new company thought, rail is going to be the way to go. We want a bridge that can be expandable, so we can generate more revenue. So, despite work having been started on the bridge, the design was changed. And Gustav Lindenthal was hired to finish the bridge. He wanted a steel bridge rather than an iron bridge. So that's how the Smithfield Street Bridge became one of the first to be built with steel. And all that iron was used to build stronger approaches with more girders than would ordinarily be built. So the process began with constructing new piers up above the previous bridge. The reason was, if you would close the bridge, you would not maintain toll revenue. So therefore, these toll companies were very inventive in keeping bridges open during construction without having to buy more land. So you can see this towers, the new piers first went up, and here's the construction of the new bridge over the old suspension bridge. Mm-hmm. Needless to say, the Smithfield Street Bridge was a lot higher than other bridges around it, and was able, still today, to be able to meet navigational requirements. So, and here's what the bridge looked like when it first opened. This beautiful Victorian portal. Now, one thing interesting about the bridge, and you can kind of see it in these piers here, these trusses were shifted all the way to the edges of the piers, because a truss bridge doesn't need as wide of a pier as a suspension bridge. That's how the company thought they could accommodate rail. Shift the bridge over, leave the stubs of those old piers, and then you can construct rail. And that's what they did in 1889, where they widened the bridge. Now notice how narrow this portal arch is. It was only a single track, and it wasn't heavy rail. It ended up being for streetcars, because the electric trolley began to be used in here in 1886 in Pittsburgh. Now, you know, the streetcar use became so popular on the bridge, and it became even more so in 1904 when the Mount Washington Transit Tunnel was built. There's a reason that that tunnel is right at the end of the Smithfield Street Bridge. Because once that tunnel opened, there was so much streetcar traffic that they widened the bridge even more in 1911. So that's, here are images of that. And as far as that portal, well, that was really, it was considered unsightly, deteriorated, out of style, so they were removed. And a few years later, in 1915, Stanley Rausch designed a current portals that hopefully we know and love. Here's a picture of the bridge when it still accommodated streetcars. Those were removed in 1985 when they were moved to the Pennsylvania Railroad Bridge. Next, we'll talk about the bridges at the city's heart, at the point. So here we have the Union Bridge, the first bridge built at the point. While Roebling's idea for this single Y-shaped bridge didn't go anywhere, instead, two different private companies built bridges at the point. The Union Bridge was built in 1875, and it was the last major covered bridge built in Pittsburgh. Now, when you think about the land at the point, you think about how low it is to the river. Needless to say, this bridge was low. Here's a picture of the bridge during high water. This bridge became such a navigational problem that the business interests and river interests petitioned the legislature, and eventually in 1889, the Department of War passed a version of the Rivers and Harbors Act, which said if a bridge obstructs navigation, it can be removed by the order of the Secretary of War. That's what happened. After petitions, this bridge was removed in 1907. On the Monongahela side, the Point Bridge was constructed in 1887, so 2 years later. Now, the Monongahela River has a slower current than the Allegheny River. So early on, the Monongahela River was the preferred river for industry. As early as the 1840s, privately owned locks and dams began to be constructed on the Monongahela River. So this bridge was better designed to accommodate commercial traffic with an 800-foot main span. So, and you can see the bridge was much higher with that large span. Now this bridge had a really unusual design in that it's used I-bar chains that were stiffened with trusses. The reason was to help the bridge become more rigid. In Wheeling, in I think it was 1853, the suspension bridge that was there collapsed due to winds. We all know Galloping Gertie, right, which collapsed due to winds. This was the solution, a very inventive solution that I don't really know how much it's been duplicated, at least to that amount. The bridge was closed in 1924, demolished in 1927. I like this image. It was purchased by a scrap company. So, and here's what the point looked like in 1894 with the original bridges. The Union Bridge, you can see again how low it is to the river, and the Point Bridge.
There's all coal barges.
And that's right, all the coal barges in the picture. Now, once the Union Bridge over the Allegheny was removed, it was replaced in 1915, so it was a few years, with the Manchester Bridge. And you can see differences for navigation. It was built with a center pier, so you could build one span, then the other span, leaving the river open for navigation. Now, something pretty interesting, this curved top cord, you can see, extends beyond the structural member and vertically. The reason was the original concept of these grand Gothic-style stone portals. The Art Commission, you know, certainly approved that design. But that was too costly, so instead, a plan to put a sculpture on either portal was instituted. Cheaper, but certainly beautiful. This one is of Chief Gaiasuda and Christopher Gist meeting between the shield of Pittsburgh. The other side had had laborers on either side. Now, when it came time to replace the bridge over the Monongahela, the Art Commission wanted a complementary structure. Now, the Manchester Bridge had a center pier. The river interests would not allow a center pier over the Monongahela. Meanwhile, they wanted an 800-foot span. At that time, you either built a cantilever bridge, which looked like this, or a suspension bridge. That's it. Arches weren't that long at that time. So how do you build a bridge like this to look like that? This stumped the engineers for a while, but they came up with this, this additional design. Now this bridge, this is an inverted cantilever, so it's pretty much the same design as this, but flipped with the road on top instead of on the bottom. Think of the Liberty Bridge, a bridge like this. So what the engineers decided to do was to use this structural form, curve the top, but hang the road below. And if you're having trouble visualizing that, here you go. So a very unusual design that was done for the sake, partially for the sake, of architecture. And this was the Second Point Bridge, and it was used from 1927 to 1959 when the Fort Pitt Bridge opened, and demolished in 1970. And this is an example of what I was talking about, where the bridge itself is rather unadorned. It's the structure of the bridge that's its artistic merit. Note, this is what the point looked like in the 1940s with the abutment of the Union Bridge. That really shows you how low that bridge was. And here's the point in 1947 with the second generation bridges. Now, after World War II, there was a lot of interest in redeveloping the point area, which was low, flooded, and had fallen into disrepair. One concept commissioned by Kaufman was through Frank Lloyd Wright to design this 1,000-foot-tall tower with arms over the two rivers. It would have been a cable-stayed bridge, which would have been the world's first modern cable-stayed bridge. There were cable-stayed bridges that were older, but they were a lot smaller in nature. I mean, you can just imagine, had this bridge been built, the international recognition it would have achieved. Certainly, though, you can also imagine how much it would cost, and therefore the design was not chosen. Instead, the Allegheny Conference explored ideas of placing a park at the point with a fountain or beacon and replacing the Manchester and Fort Pitt bridges. Now, in this older concept, you can see that they're truss bridges, and you can see these loop ramps that intruded into the park. Partly due to the decision to eliminate streetcars, the requirement for streetcars for these bridges, the engineers came up with an idea of having a double-deck design. Therefore, you do not have the loop ramps into the park. As you can imagine, when you're on the Parkway East, it's just a simple turn, some challenging turn, but simple turn onto the Fort Pitt Bridge. And this bridge is noteworthy in other ways too. It was the first tied arch bridge. A tied arch bridge has the two ends of the bow tied together to prevent outward thrust, because you can see how thin the arch shape is. It was the first tied arch with a double deck road. It was an early bridge that used computer assisted calculations. David Lawrence, Pittsburgh's mayor, when a lot of the concepts of Pittsburgh Renaissance One projects were being conceived and was governor at this point, said, "This bridge has a special importance as a testimonial to the rejuvenation of a city." So think about that the next time you're trying to drive across the bridge in rush hour. And the bridge was matched by the Fort Duquesne Bridge, where again the structure was chosen to complement the Fort Pitt Bridge structure. It was completed sort of in the early 1960s, and by sort of, it was completed to this point. And another 8 years went by until a ramp was built, earning it the name the Bridge to Nowhere, as Reach Cordick mentioned earlier. He was famous for his bridge leap contest. Now, there is a reported story of someone driving across the bridge, as you may be aware. I just want to show you this picture. This is what the end of the bridge looked like. Notice the various stringers with no deck. Can you imagine a car driving across here and over the end? I had a high school teacher who claimed he knew the person and it was a hoax. Now, I can't say definitively, but it does seem a lot more plausible when you look at this picture that it would have been a hoax. Next, we'll talk about the Three Sisters bridges. This was the old 6th Street and the old 7th Street there. So, the Roebling Bridge was replaced in 1893. Why? Because it could not carry the new electric streetcars that debuted a few years earlier. So the bridge company wanted to build a new suspension bridge, but the design was changed to a truss because the truss could be built around the old suspension bridge, leaving the old bridge open to traffic. So in just 95 days, this truss structure was erected around the old suspension bridge. The next bridge was at 7th Street. It's the newest of the Three Sisters. It was built in 1884. It was designed by Gustav Lindenthal the year after he finished the Smithfield Street Bridge. Here's some images of the bridge with the old horse cars, the horse pull transit vehicles. It was that one there. And then on to the 9th Street Bridge. The first bridge was a covered bridge from 1839. Again, the bridge itself was purchased by a streetcar company to add an electric streetcar line. They chose this truss design built on the original bridge piers so they could build the truss around the old covered bridge. Now, it was designed by Ferris Kaufman and Company, and this is the same Ferris that invented the Ferris wheel. Now, as Pittsburgh developed, these bridges became problematic. As you can imagine in this picture, now this is with a flood, but look at how these bridges were still relatively low and the pier arrangements were not complementary. These bridges were part of the reason that the Allegheny River, even as more powerful boats were developed, was still slow to develop like the Monongahela. So, there were several petitions to try to get these bridges removed, just like with the Union Bridge. But the Secretary of War said these bridges did not pose a problem. After the city of Pittsburgh annexed the city of Allegheny, they purchased these bridges, these non-obstructive bridges, in 1911. Well, shortly afterwards, in the build-up to World War I, now these bridges became navigation issues, and now the city of Pittsburgh was on the hook to replace the bridges. So all of these new bridges had to have no center piers, 400-foot main span minimum, sufficient height clearances, and art commission approval. All of those were very formidable challenges. But before I get into that, I just want to note that the old 6th Street Bridge was in good shape, was rather new, and instead of being demolished, it was lowered onto barges and floated to Coriopolis along the Ohio River, and where it was reused, and you may remember the bridge was there until 1994. Now, you can't see it in this picture, but the next bridge over was the Manchester Bridge. They ended up having to disassemble the top of the bridge to be able to float it underneath the Manchester Bridge. So, if you think about the areas to the area's topography. A lot of the rivers have a floodplain on one side and a hillside on the other. So having bridges that were tall enough wouldn't be an issue. There was high ground to tie into. However, in a way, downtown is the Monongahela River's floodplain, and the north side, or Allegheny, was the Allegheny River's floodplain. So here's the case where you're going from low ground to low ground. Therefore, the engineers were concerned with vehicles, especially horse-drawn vehicles, making a slope to go up over a bridge. They came up with this idea of this continuous traffic lift. Note this dashed line here. The concept was for these spans to be able to raise up by 14 feet when water levels were high. So rather than being a conventional movable bridge that would move up when a boat needed to go through, these bridges would move up for the times of the year where water was high, and traffic could run across the bridge in its raised condition. And then the drier times of the year with lower water levels, again, this is before the locks and a lot of the locks and the dams were built on the Allegheny River, then the bridge could be lowered. Well, this idea went nowhere, and there was a lot of concern. If you had a mechanical problem, you'd be back where you started. And the Art Commission didn't like these designs. So the engineers then came up with this concept for the 6th, 7th, and 9th Street bridges, of truss bridges. Everything was going along well with the design, and the engineers assumed the Art Commission would approve it. Nope, the Art Commission said, no, we want suspension bridges. The engineers said, we couldn't build suspension bridges here for various reasons, such as building anchorages and problems that they had with the old suspension bridges. And the Art Commission said, okay, well, we want suspension bridges. So the solution was a bridge modeled after one in Europe. Does this bridge not look familiar? This bridge has not existed since about 1945. During World War II, this bridge was demolished. But this was the model where the bridge is a self-anchored suspension bridge, where these cables are anchored into the bridge itself. Now, that created a new challenge, because now the bridge deck is a structural member. You can't hang the bridge deck from the cables during construction. So the engineers came up with a way of building this bridge as a cantilever, building it as a truss bridge, and then, when everything was done, removing the trusses and forming the self-anchored suspension. So you can see these diagonals here. You can see they're temporary struts and a temporary truss. You can see during construction, the anchor spans were built first, and then the main span was cantilevered outwards. You can see the struts and the truss being constructed. And then once the bridge was finished, you could remove the temporary truss. And now, from 1926 through 1928, the current three sisters that we love were completed. So you can see that they are used in the logo of Pittsburgh's 200th anniversary. Now you can appreciate just how much of a challenge went into building the country's first self-anchored suspension bridges. Why? Because the Art Commission thought you should be able to walk across the bridge and marvel at the view of the city. Next we'll talk about is the 16th Street or David McCullough Bridge. Originally it was a covered bridge, and this bridge had quite a history where it burned in 1851, was flooded in 1865, and at the same time that the old Three Sisters were declared as an obstruction to navigation, so was this bridge. In deciding what to do, well, conveniently the bridge burned, and that solved that problem. But because of the fire, it was one of the first to go away. So it was one of the first to be replaced. Now the Art Commission thought that an architect should be the project manager, not an engineer. So they commissioned Warren and Wetmore, famous for their work with train stations, to serve as project manager. One interesting thing of note, if you look at the armillary spheres that adorn the bridge, they were based on this fountain in Paris. So the next time you're in Paris and you're in the Luxembourg Gardens, make sure you stroll to the this beautiful fountain. It's right by RER station. Next we'll talk about some of the bridges in Herz Island. Well, here's the only image I could find of the first bridge to Herz Island. It's a wooden covered bridge that went across the back channel around 30th Street. And it was built when the island was developed around 1860, and there it is, flooded away in 1882. It was replaced with this truss bridge in 1883. It was raised in 1902, to eliminate a crossing with the rail line on the north side. Now, Herz Island became the place that the Pennsylvania Railroad consolidated their slaughterhouses. Also, people would bring their animals to the island for slaughter. In 1924, two guys were driving their truck of hogs across this bridge, and they found themselves in the river. Unfortunately, the one guy drowned, but the other guy managed to grab onto the back of a hog that carried him to shore. This is before the bridge inspection standards that we have today.
Saved by a pig.
In 1939, the bridge was replaced through the Works Progress Administration, which provided some federal funding. This is the first time through the Great Depression Recovery funding. This was really the first time that federal dollars went into bridges. The new bridge was built next to the old one, and by the Eichley Company, slid it into place to, again, not disrupt traffic. And this bridge was replaced in 1986. Because of the back channel bridge, the main channel bridge was built to tie in. It was also designed in the 1880s by Gustav Lindenthal. As far as I can tell, he designed at least four bridges in Pittsburgh at that time. Interestingly, this was a completely continuous truss where the truss structure just went directly across the river, a type that is very difficult to calculate before computers. And this bridge burned in 1921. And by burned, it burned. And the bridge carried a gas line, apparently a spark maybe from a steamship, ignited the wooden deck, caught the gas line on fire, and the bridge happened to cross an area where coal barges were stored and caught four coal barges on fire. So you can imagine the devastation. And also remember, this is the time where the 16th Street Bridge was also lost to fire. So you think things are bad today, well, imagine both of those bridges being out. And that was when the 40th Street Bridge was still a wooden covered bridge and couldn't accommodate much traffic. So the bridge was replaced in 1928 with this deck arch design. Again, the Art Commission wanted the support structure to be below the road. If you think about any of the bridges built after the Manchester Bridge, there is no truss structure on any of the city's bridges above the road deck. Compare that when you go outside of the city for bridges like the New Kensington Bridge or the McKeesport Duquesne Bridge, bridges that were built at the same time by the county, but they were the cheaper, simpler truss design. So that just really shows the care that went into these city bridges. But in order to build this deck arch design, the bridge was now too high to tie into Herz Island. If you've ever tried to get off of Herz Island in rush hour, you know that it's quite an issue. So it's interesting when you see how, in cases like this, the form was more important than the function. And now, the last time I was here, I talked about the Homestead High Level Bridge, but I have to mention it very briefly because it's a special bridge. It replaced this truss bridge, which was built by investors including Captain Samuel Brown of Browns Hill Road. It carried the streetcar line from Squirrel Hill. As the Homestead Works expanded, they needed a new bridge. And the other issue was when you crossed this bridge, you had to cross all of the rail tracks in Lower Homestead. It was reported that there were 180 trains a day. That's an average of 7.5 trains an hour. So if you think it's hard to get out of the waterfront now, you can imagine what it was like then. So the bridge was replaced in 1937 with the area's first example of a wicker truss. This is the original patent drawing, which came up with this assembly where there are hinges at each point of this diamond, which what it did was it allowed each span to flex independently. That rendered the structure statically determinate, and that allowed engineers to be more easily able to calculate it. And here's what the bridge looked like in the 1980s with the steel mills behind it. As I mentioned, it was built at a high level to avoid all the rail crossings, and even today, it is still the longest bridge over the Monongahela River. So here's an old map showing the old alignment of Saline Street, or Saline Avenue as it was called. This area has since been obstructed by the slag dumps. The old bridge, this is about where Eaton Park is today, and you can see here's Amity Street. And you can watch when the Homestead High Level Bridge was built. You can see it was built across. The old Saline Street Bridge was here, and this is old Browns Hill Road. And then as we move into modern times, here's what the area looks like today. Next, we'll talk about the Ohio River bridges, certainly the largest and most monumental bridges in the area. The West End Bridge is special of its size. At 778 feet, it was 240 feet longer than the Tacony-Palmyra Bridge in the Philadelphia area, which at the time was the record-breaking structure. It also used high-strength steel and wire rope as hangers. Next time you cross the West End Bridge, you'll notice there's rope. If you cross the McKees Rocks Bridge or the Jerome Street Bridge, they're steel hangers. So this was a novel concept of stressing the wires first, so in that way they wouldn't deflect any, you know, additionally subject to the load when they would be installed. Next is a bridge that we don't really think about that much, the Ohio Connecting Railroad Bridge. This is one of the most interesting. Rail congestion got so heavy that the railroad decided to build this bypass around the city. And they built it over Bruno's Island because the river channel was narrowest. However, there's one thing if you obstruct the Allegheny River, but if you obstruct the Ohio River, you're obstructing both the Allegheny and the Monongahela. So a lot of care had to be taken to build such a bridge. As you can see, the main truss was built off-site and floated into place. Now this is 75 feet up. This is a 523-foot-long span. This is comparable to about a span of the Homestead High Level Bridge. So you can just imagine, in 1890, moving this structure into place. And there's what it looked like, one of the longest bridges built at the time, 4,500 feet long. However, this expensive bridge was only a single track and quickly became overwhelmed with traffic. The railroad knew they had to widen it. They had to build a new bridge. So I'll go through these graphics to show you how they built the new bridge. Since the new bridge would be two tracks, they could build it around the old structure. And they had to do it in such a way to keep the river open. Well, the engineers realized since there's a main span and a back channel span, they could build the back channel span to cantilever the main channel span to avoid obstructing the river. And I'll illustrate that concept. So first they built the anchorages. This is part of the back channel span over the main channel. Then they cantilevered out the main truss. And they were able to build that main truss. Then they were able to disassemble and move the back channel spans in place to complete the bridge. So a very novel method of construction there in 1913. And this is what the bridge looks like today, just to give you that sense of scale. It is a truly massive bridge. The last bridge in the city over the Ohio is the McKees Rocks Bridge. It was the first vehicular bridge built over the Ohio in Pittsburgh. It wasn't till the War Department agreed to let the engineers design a bridge that was only 750 feet long, with a 750-foot span, as opposed to the 1,100-foot span that they wanted, that they agreed to build this bridge. So the bridge opened in 1931. I don't know how many people turned out, but certainly it was quite a spectacle. Now, the design was modeled after New York City's Hellgate Bridge, which reportedly was the largest bridge built with Carnegie steel at the time. This is the Hellgate Bridge, and that's the McKees Rocks Bridge. So you can see how similar the designs are. So here's a picture of the completed bridge, 5,900 feet long, including the river spans and the spans over the Pittsburgh and Lake Erie Railroad Yard. Now, because this is Squirrel Hill, I have to mention the bridges by Squirrel Hill's Carnegie Mellon University. So here's a map of Forbes Avenue and Beeler Street. This parcel became Schenley Park. So this is the area that's Carnegie Mellon University. So the first trolley line was chartered in 1887 to Squirrel Hill, before the university and before Schenley Park. And here's the original line. It followed John Kerr Street, had a low bridge over the valley. It came alongside this ravine, this is where Wien and Doherty Halls are today, onto Margaret Morrison Street. And if you're having a little trouble visualizing that, take a look at Carnegie Mellon today. And now we'll take a look at them both. So you can see how the old rail line went alongside Hammerschlag Hall, then past the new Scott Hall, Wien and Doherty, and then onto Margaret Morrison Street. So if you're wondering why there's a stub of in front of Margaret Morrison Street, you know, at one point the road did turn here, but that was the original road alignment. And old postcards have confirmed there were streetcar tracks in front of Margaret Morrison Hall. Now, this quickly became an issue when Schenley Park, the land for Schenley Park was purchased in 1889, and the city did not want a streetcar line in the park. In 1896, there was the Schenley Park Casino over here burned, and with it went the bridges. So that helped, you know, helped relocate, you know, provide the reason to relocate the streetcar tracks to Forbes Avenue, which required replacing the previous Forbes Avenue bridge. So here's an image of Junction Hollow. This is the old streetcar bridge, and this was the original Schenley Bridge. So the museum would be over here, Carnegie Mellon here, Phipps Conservatory over there. Here's the image of the streetcar alongside what's today Hammerschlag Hall, and there's the original Forbes Avenue Bridge. That bridge was replaced in 1898 to accommodate the streetcars. And here's the Schenley Bridge, which was replaced in 1897. In 1896, the Panther Hollow Bridge was being constructed at another point in Schenley Park. This bridge burned so that the engineers were able to reuse the same design, and that's one of the reasons that these bridges look almost identical. Also, another bridge that was demolished in that fire was the original Belfield Bridge, which connected between the museum and where Forbes Field used to be. There used to be a ravine there. Here's an old map. Here's the original Carnegie Public Library, and Forbes Field would have been built over here. So the library over here, and the Forbes Field was over here. So that stone arch bridge, which replaced the wooden bridge burned in the fire, was 150 feet long and 100 feet high. So that really shows you how big that ravine used to be. But the ravine was filled in 1912 to 1915. And you can imagine, if you're filling in a ravine here, and you're going to fill in the bridge, you would build Schenley Drive around where the old bridge was. So the old Belfield Bridge is here, right under the fountain, and Schenley Drive was relocated as an arc around the old bridge. And this fountain was built using the beautiful foundation of the old stone bridge. The last thing I'll talk about tonight is the City Beautiful concrete arch bridges. And here's what the Beechwood Boulevard Bridge used to look like. So, when the City Beautiful movement was really developing in the late 1800s and early 1900s, also known as the Beaux-Arts movement. As a reaction to a lot of these hastily constructed, unsightly structures. Now, the Adolphe Bridge opened in the early 1900s in Luxembourg, and that was the first major open spandrel, beautiful concrete arch bridge. Philadelphia copied the bridge by the existing Walnut Lane Bridge in 1908, and then everyone had to have this type of bridge to be the beautiful bridge in a park-like setting. The city began building their first in 1910. It's the Meadow Street Bridge. You can see, well, this isn't exactly a park-like setting, but the plan was to eventually incorporate the Snegley Run Valley into the park. Today, there are no houses in that valley. So, one by one, the city began to replace the old truss bridges with City Beautiful style. Here's Murray Avenue right there. Hess Run, which was right by the Pittsburgh Zoo, the old Beechwood Boulevard Bridge. So one by one, the city began to upgrade their old bridges to be beautiful concrete arch bridges. You can see what a difference this makes compared with the old structures. Mm-hmm. And here are some other City Beautiful bridges that they built. So there's the completed Meadow Street Bridge. This was on McArdle Roadway. And this was Baum Boulevard, over the Pennsylvania Railroad and Junction Railroad. That's the chute that shoots from the old Luna Park in that picture there. So, out of all of these bridges, only the arch of the Larmer Avenue Bridge and the arch of the Meadow Street Bridge still survive. But you can see what a difference these beautiful style bridges made in architecture at the time. And with that, I just want to say thank you. I always enjoy presenting about bridges, and I'm more than happy to answer questions. And also, if anyone's interested in the Pittsburgh Bridges book, we are more than happy to discount it to $20, and we'll sign it for you. So thank you.
If we wanted to enhance the look of the point, why doesn't someone initiate a project to string lighting on the 7th and the 10th Street Bridge and the Smithfield and the Birmingham Bridge, just two bridges, and that lighting would really enhance architecture and the look of both rivers?
Yeah. I completely, totally, and absolutely agree with you. You can just imagine the spectacle from Mount Washington of the city with every bridge lit. I know Pittsburgh History and Landmarks Foundation had had initiatives in the past to try to do so, where they lit the Smithfield Street Bridge and helped with the 6th Street Bridge, and then I don't even know if the lighting is still used on the Hot Metal Bridge. I was there for the dedication of the lighting on the Hot Metal Bridge, and Governor Rendell said, well, do you want us to, we've only been have enough money to light the portals. Do you want us to light the portals or wait till we can do the whole bridge? And everyone said, just turn on the lights now. So it's a costly process, though, with modern LED lighting less costly than it was 10 years ago. And it's certainly something I think we as Pittsburghers really should advocate, because it really would draw attention and beauty to our carefully designed bridges.
Hot Metal Bridge down the river is just good.
How many bridges does Pittsburgh have?
So I love the question of how many bridges there are in Pittsburgh. And the reason is because a lot of people have tried to find out. I recall being here at the Squirrel Hill Historical Society, where a certain author mentioned that did a lot of research and mentioned that there are 446. However, there's not necessarily a clear definition of what is a bridge. For a bridge to be a bridge considered by the government, it has to be 20 feet long. That means any of those beautiful stone and concrete bridges in the parks wouldn't be considered bridges. Now, do you consider them bridges? I mean, I do. So really, the only way to find out would be to use high-resolution images, aerial imagery, and manually count them one by one.
Yeah.
Bridges are owned by so many different people. They're owned by the government, they're owned by railroads, they're owned by parks, and there are some houses that have bridges on their property. So there really is no other way that I know of to count them than that. So let's say about 500, but I wish I could tell you more.
There are two types of bridges that are missing in Pittsburgh that I can think of. One is a movable bridge, and the other...
Can't hear you.
Well, there may have been a movable bridge at one time, but I don't think there is now.
Correct.
And the other is a cable-stayed bridge. You have to go to Steubenville to find a cable-stayed bridge.
That's correct. The comment was that there are two types of bridges that we lack, movable bridges and cable-stayed bridges. And which certainly, I don't know of any movable bridges that ended up being constructed. You saw in the presentation that some were proposed. And I doubt that there are any plans to construct a movable bridge. Now the other type of cable-stayed bridge, the nearest one, as mentioned, is in Steubenville. Believe it or not, there is not a single vehicular cable-stayed bridge anywhere in Pennsylvania. Now, Ohio has been building them for example, there's a small one right by the Ohio State University, where Ohio has been building them for aesthetics, to build new beautiful bridges. But we have not yet seen that type or that concept here in Pennsylvania. However, the original plan, or the plans of a few years ago, to build the Monfayette Bridge over the Monongahela River was to build a cable-stayed bridge. Now the project is supposedly back on. I don't know if that design will change or not, but maybe there's a chance that we can get Pennsylvania's first. It'd certainly be a nice attraction from Kennywood, right?
Yes. Two questions. What was the project that filled in the ravine under the Bellfield Bridge?
That's a good question. A lot of the material that was filled in the Bellfield Bridge was taken when they lowered Grant's Hump in downtown Pittsburgh.
Mm-hmm. And the second question is, our bridges were featured in 60 Minutes,
mm-hmm.
or on 60 Minutes, and they talked about the disrepair of our bridges and the bridge that's now been torn down, that the Greenfield Bridge that mm-hmm. had a bridge under it to mm-hmm. capture the debris falling. So what is the state of our bridges today, and what's it going to cost to bring them up to speed?
Well, see, and that's an excellent question, because of what is the state of our bridges and what it will cost to bring them up to speed. There's certainly been a big focus in Pennsylvania in the past 10 years to upgrade the bridges, and bridges have been receiving a much larger share of dollars versus other projects. If you consider all of, you know, a lot of this bridge work going on as compared with building new roads. How many new roads have you seen in this area in the past few years? So it's certainly a major push. And I don't know, you know, what the cost would be, but also you have questions of, do you repair or do you replace? Because you can spend money to fix whatever's, you know, whatever's the main structural issue with the bridge, but how long is it going to last until it needs another repair? So for reasons like that, a lot of the bridge owners have decided they don't want to fix the older bridges. They just want to go with all new, wider bridges. So that cost could vary greatly, but it's certainly something that has been a focus and continues to be a focus in Pennsylvania. And certainly you hear a lot about needing to raise funding to be able to keep all the bridges in perfect condition.
Were the construction firms that built these bridges local firms like the American Bridge Works?
Generally, a lot of the contractors themselves were local, and there were various contractors that would specialize in various parts of the bridge. Like, some companies would specialize in just building the foundations. A company like the American Bridge Company would specialize in building the superstructure. But as time went on, the industry has consolidated, what would be local companies 100, 150 years ago, a lot of times are large international companies with a local office building them today. Yes?
Not a question, just a comment. Besides being an excellent park, the graphics I thought were incredible, especially the overlays and the characters that were kind of brilliant. Thank you. Can you repeat what she said? Maybe it's not here.
Thank you so much for saying that the overlays and graphics were really enjoyable and well done. I just have to say, there are so many more graphics I would love to show you. One of the most interesting overlays I find anywhere is Bates Street.
Mm-hmm.
So, because when you're coming up Bates Street and you're sitting at the intersection of the Boulevard of the Allies, that part of Bates Street is on film. You feel like you're in a valley because you're depressed on either side, but that part was filled. What's now the Boulevard of the Allies, if you take a look in the book, was the Halkett Street Bridge, and that part of Bay Street was built to tie into a retaining wall. If you look at the row houses at that intersection, you'll see that the main floor is a level up, that you have to walk up steps outside the row houses from their basements up until their first floor. And that street was lowered. They weren't originally like that. So I could go on for hours. So I really appreciate it. So thank you so much.
On the Manchester Bridge, you said the guy who suited was on one end.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't hear who you said was on the other.
They were two laborers. A mill worker was one, and I believe a miner was the other one. I can double check.
That's good to hear.
But,
I wanted to broach the subject of naming a bridge. Mm-hmm. The Beachwood Boulevard Bridge had just went down.
Mm-hmm.
There was a group that started to trying to get consensus to have that bridge named for John Kane, the Pittsburgh primitive artist,
mm-hmm.
who actually worked in 1922. He was a laborer on that bridge. He was 62 years old with a wooden leg. He was the oldest guy on there. And this is 5 years before he's known as the painter of
mm-hmm.
Pittsburgh and all
mm-hmm.
the bridges.
Mm-hmm.
Growing up in Pittsburgh, we always hear that the immigrant labor built everything, the bridges that worked in the mill. Well, he actually worked on Edgar Thompson Works. He knew Frick from the coal mines, from the coal fields in Connellsville. He paved Bigelow Boulevard. He paved Fifth Avenue coming up, and he worked on that bridge. So we hear about these laborers who built everything, but we have nothing named for them. We have the Clemente Bridge for the great athlete, the Rachel Carson Bridge for environment, David McCullough for history, of course, Warhol for the most famous. But here's my hero, John Kane, who is in 15 museums around the world. 10 of his paintings are in the Carnegie. And there is a commission for naming public properties that meets quarterly. So we're going to hopefully get some consensus that people think that might be a good idea to have at the John Kane Bridge. The city or the public works seems to think that historically the Beachwood Boulevard Bridge would be the name they want to keep. But there was a bridge before that bridge. What was that one called?
That was built, so the bridge at that location was originally built for Beachwood Boulevard, where in 1889 the city purchased land for their first two parks, Highland and Shenley, and Beachwood Boulevard was drawn up to follow the contours as a grand urban boulevard to connect the two parks, and to start, and it happened to be to start and end on a bridge. Now you might say, Beachwood Boulevard doesn't go to Highland Park, right? Well, another point, the Beachwood Boulevard was discontinuous by a few blocks where it ran into Fifth Avenue. And it turned out the part of the boulevard beyond Fifth Avenue was renamed Washington Boulevard.
Mm-hmm.
And there was talk of naming this part of Beachwood Boulevard is the William Pitt Boulevard Bridge. In fact, I've seen that name, too, attributed to the original structure. But it ended up staying as Beachwood Boulevard.
Well, we think and we hope that with more education of who John Kane is and what he meant to the city, and that we can, instead of it being the Beachwood Boulevard Bridge, really, the Greenfield Bridge, as
right.
people know.
Exactly.
That could be the John Kane Bridge, even if it was a Greenfield Bridge.
And I think that that's a really excellent concept, and certainly.
Well, I just, thank you, and I just heard about this in transit, so I didn't bring any John Kane. Let's take a look at what John Kane has done for our city.
Maybe you could give a talk on him.
Yeah.
And he did paint a picture of the Larmer Avenue.
Right.
The Greenfield Bridge.
He painted at least a dozen Pittsburgh paintings, but not that one. But he built it.
Right, which is certainly certainly important there. And I'd say with any advocacy, how many people honestly have called that bridge the Beachwood Boulevard Bridge? How many people have called it the Greenfield Bridge? So if the city's insistent on keeping the official name the Beachwood Boulevard Bridge, it seems only fair that we could call it something else.
The trolley tunnel to the South Hills, mm-hmm. you said it was developed in 1897.
The widened, I believe the trolley tunnel was opened in 1904.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I think it was built in 1848.
That was that was built, but that was in a different location in the Coal Hill. If you know where the Castle Shannon incline was, it was, think about like the valley that's bridged by Sycamore Street and the McArdle Roadway. I believe that tunnel was built in, you know, in about that area, is the coal tunnel. But they are separate tunnels, but I believe too, due to that, you know, the transport to that tunnel was essentially Pittsburgh's first funicular, I believe.
There's another feature, and that is the spectacular views from the bridges. My favorite still is a view that was really striking. I had just come from my basic training and was on my way on a troop train east to Fort Dix, New Jersey, to go overseas, and the train stopped, and I looked out, and there was this spectacular view of a river with steel mills glowing in the dark. It was just absolutely wonderful. I'd never seen anything like it. Right from the Smithfield Street Bridge, looking up the Mon and seeing it. I still remember it with a great feeling. And for a while, it was my last great view of America till I came home after the war was over. It was pretty great.
That's certainly a, you know, fantastic story.
Yeah.
So thank you for sharing. I think hopefully all of us want to, you know, if you see paintings or pictures, just to be able to think of, you know, a vivid image like that. So all right. Well, so thank you so much.
Thank you all for coming, and we do have a custom that we have to put the chairs away, so, and yeah, the books will be over there with Todd. If you just fold your chair and, like, lean it against the wall, and we'll put it away from there, we'd appreciate it. Thank you so much for coming.